with me today is an incredible panel. We're going to talk a little bit about the third offset from a sort of different perspective, trying to drill down what it actually is, whether or not it's actually happening, what happens to make it happen better, and who's offsetting our offset. So joining me today is Pete Newell. He runs Hacking for Defense out of Stanford University. He's a retired Army colonel. And just a quick note on Pete. Before there was a Defense Innovation Unit experimental, there was a guy in Silicon Valley that was bridging these two worlds really spectacularly, Washington, D.C., and Silicon Valley innovation, and that's Pete. So he's kind of the Merlin to the entire DIUX idea, and has a really unique perspective on what Silicon Valley and Washington have been doing well together and what they could stand to be doing better together. Also here, Dr. Will Roper. He's the director of the Strategic Capabilities Office at the Secretary of Defense, also called SCO. Ms. Su-Jin Chang, she is the principal and Center of Acquisition Management Sciences at MITRE. And everybody knows Dr. P.W. Singer, best-selling author, strategist, man about town, tieless, upstart. And so we're just going to dive right in, talking a little bit about, first with Pete. We've heard a lot today about the third offset strategy, everything that's working well with it, and how terribly on track it is, all of the tremendous innovation it's going to yield for the country in the battles ahead. What is your perspective on whether or not the third offset strategy is proceeding, how it could proceed better, and what do people say when you go out and talk to actual folks in the field across the services when they talk about the offset strategy? What do they tell you?
So I'm trying to count in my head as you were asking the question on the number of panels and discussions I've had related to the offset strategy. And I think this is probably the sixth one in the last couple of years. So I would say from the perspective of how we're doing, you know, we have come light years from the first iteration of conversations about, you know, when we first started talking about offset strategies, it was about what technology was going to come next. Mm-hmm. And I think we finally divorced ourselves from the fact that it's going to be a technology answer to the offset strategy, and it's really going to be about speed and the ability to recognize that something has changed in the world and that we will have to find a technological answer to that change repetitively. Mm-hmm. And it really, you know, we started a couple of years ago with the idea that, you know, the idea of technological dominance is probably gone, or has become simply a temporal activity, which means you can get it, but you're not going to keep it very long. Mm-hmm. And in many cases, the way the world works now is that the speed of the cycle of being able to get something out there that's going to count more than in how good your technology is the day you show up.
Okay.
So from my perspective, having watched it and participated in a couple of years, we are having the right conversation now. I think in many cases we are still moving slowly in the direction of figuring out how we're going to apply the human capital, what changes we're going to have to make organizationally across the entire defense industry in order to have that.
Decisive advantage.
So I think if we're wrestling with it, and we've heard today about so many of the benefits of it, and you know, up front, I'm a big fan of the approach, and I would lay out sort of, you know, four different reasons why. You know, one is it recognizes the weight of the challenge that we face, that this is something that's you know, the comparison is sometimes made with IEDs and we need to push out MRAPs. No, this is a whole of department, a national, truly national security level success or failure for the nation type dilemma that it's wrestling with. It faces, although it's harder for people to talk about it inside government, for those of us outside government, it faces the geopolitical change. I mean, look, the third offset is about the return of state threats and great powers. Mm-hmm. So it's not about failed states. It's about the challenge stemming from powerful states. It's not about networks of insurgents or terrorists. It's about hierarchical, organized militaries. I think it recognizes that there's a number of technology shifts going on. That's a positive. And clearly there have been a number of investments in pushing forward, whether it's creating new offices or investing in new actual programs. I'd lay out, though, three challenges. You know, they pay me the big bucks to come here and you know, kind of toss in at zero. So one is there a shared idea of the third offset, and is it truly spread across the system? So when I, this is, you know, anecdotal, but when I speak to senior Army versus Air Force versus Navy officers, they have very different concepts of what the third offset is, what it means for them. That's, of course, it's not just the third offset, but the scenarios that they care about, worry about, wake up at night about, they're very different. There's very different visions of the best and worst case of the world and the move forward. The spread of the ideas, again, anecdotally, it's, you know, just literally yesterday was out in Wisconsin with their National Guard, and senior leader there said, you know, they're working on this new thing called the third offset. We don't yet know what it is, but it's going to be important. That's very different than us gathering and doing kind of a multi-year assessment of it. Second challenge, is it actually being implemented as widely as arguably it should? There's been a lot of neat investments, but you know, when you run them against the overall numbers in the Pentagon budget, true big, big programs of record, that's harder. So you know, a different way of putting it is, can we identify major programs of record that have either begun or ended in the time period that we're talking about? Major programs of record. Another way of putting it is, who's been made most uncomfortable by the third offset? And if we can't say anyone, then we maybe haven't made a true level of change. The final is, adversaries are already moving to offset our offset. So yesterday, for example, we published an article at Popular Science about China running its own version of the DARPA Grand Challenge, where they showed off five different ground autonomous systems that have been the winners of these kind of contests. Or if you're looking at armed robots as opposed to autonomous ones, which are related but different, in the time of the offset, you know, they've been shown off at trade shows, Chinese ones, Russian ones, even Iran, Ukraine, you name it. So there's already moves to offset us and the offset, so it's got to stay dynamic, which is, of course, the challenge we're aware of, but that's one of the things that's there.
Yeah, so turning now to Will, because your job is kind of to offset the people offsetting our offset at the Strategic Capabilities Office. And one of the means that we have for doing that is, it's a theme that I see popping up more and more frequently all over the place. You listen to General McMaster talk about it with great passion, and it's shown up a few times here today, and that's the idea of cross-domain fires and cross-domain effectiveness, where you've got the services all sort of melding together and operators fulfilling this wide variety of functions. Just today, we heard about from Secretary Carter, for those playing at home, this is kind of a news item, talking a little about the ACMs thing, the new missile where you're going to allow basically infantrymen to take out ships and things like this. So from your perspective, where are we in the offset life cycle? Have we already made our offset obsolete? And tell us a little bit about cross-domain capability and a role that plays in this.
So, Simple things to discuss, so yeah. I'm sure I'll be finished in 30 seconds.
That's
so, one word first on how you offset the adversaries trying to offset your offset. It's mm-hmm. very simple to do that. You just don't talk about your best capabilities, plain and simple. So one of the things we're going to have to remember that we did quite well in the Cold War is having a good balance between the capabilities that we show to the world for deterrence versus those that we keep behind the door for warfighting overmatch. That is something we've been wrestling with in SCO for 4 years now. And though we have a lot of cool capabilities, another one was announced today by the Secretary, we are keeping our best ideas behind the door, and probably always will, because what we owe to our future operators is an unfair fight. And the second that you show a capability that has promise, you've got to expect that great powers, unlike, you know, lesser countries or terrorist groups, are going to be able to emulate that capability and potentially implement it, even if their operators aren't as good as ours. And to your second point, what is a theme around which good ideas tend to cluster for us? Mm-hmm. It is cross-domain. One of the reasons that cross-domain capabilities tend to be a canonical good idea is that it's easier to engineer in effect than it is to train and counter. So for me, taking a missile like ATACMS, which is an awesome name for a missile, that's a fire it from land, hit another point on land missile today. So probably not surprising to any of you that given the number of seekers that we have under development in the department, that we believe that we'll be able to take an existing one, retrofit it on that Army missile, and now we can hit moving things on land. But with the seeker, now you can also go do moving targets at sea. So doing that seeker integration and fielding it is not a very difficult project for an office like SCO working with the Army. But now, if you're an adversary, you now have a much more complicated thing to plan against. Mm-hmm. You're not just planning against maritime capabilities and air capabilities threatening your naval assets. You now have to worry about targeting coming from land. And so I think the more that domains blur, the more that we can affect that, we're going to create permutations for adversaries that will create a disproportionate burden for them to train for. And wherever we can put burden that comes down to the human level, I think we get an immediate advantage in the near term. And SCO is a near-term part of the offset. I will stack the burden of training for multi-domain fires, for multi-domain effects. I will take our operators getting ready to do that agilely and quickly better than any other country in the world. I'll take that bet any day. And so that's an area where the human advantage coupled with the technology plays in our favor. And we try to affect it wherever we can.
Does that make up for something that I've heard also a lot from commanders, which is the loss of air superiority? It's not. As you look at the proliferation of small UAVs on the battlefield, I hear from a lot of different folks talking about how air superiority is no longer a thing that we can just sort of like take for granted. Is that sort of the reverse side of cross-domain entering the battle space for all operators?
It's not a pure reversal, but with respect to air superiority, one thing that is changing is just the number of ways to create what was once exclusive to the air domain.
Right.
In the past, you had to develop an air force and train pilots so that you could fly a plane to put metal on a target abroad. Mm-hmm. Now you can simply bypass that by building a cruise missile or ballistic missile. That was an appealing strategy 10 years ago. Bypass your bomber force and buy missiles, right? Missiles that you don't have to train, you just fire. So that makes sense strategically. It takes you away from having to get human capital developed and trained. What we're seeing now, as you point out, is that now there's another way to create a different kind of air presence, and that's using what is the continually evolving commercial drone world, with technology available to everyone. And it won't just be great powers who will be able to use it. It'll trickle down all the way to terrorist groups.
Right.
And so it's not changing high-end air dominance that we've had in the past and what manned systems will do. But if we don't find a way to cleverly combine our high-end systems with this emerging, ubiquitous, expendable commercial technology around us, we're likely to find ourselves painted in a corner. So one idea about how to do that, and it's a very cool, fun program, and it's one that we've decided to acknowledge a few months ago when the Secretary brought it out, was the fact that we're putting micro UAVs inside of our fighters. So we can build now, with commercial tech, expendable UAVs that we can kick out of fighters in quantity that can do missions by swarming together so that a lot of small things act as a big thing. And because it's commercial technology, we just leave it behind. Don't need to get it back, because any one of us could go buy the components in that system. So having a tactical aircraft that can put out a swarm of low-flying surveillance asset allows a tactical aircraft to do a mission that it can't today. I don't need a Reaper or Predator to provide ISR. I'll just carry my ISR with me. And if I have a Reaper or Predator, great, but if I don't, then I've got an alternative way to still get my mission done. And that's I think those kinds of pairings, Frankensteining of high-end and low-end, I think that's going to occur across all domains.
How far are we from being able to implement that in the field, deploy that to an AOR, maybe one that we're in today?
We're getting very close. Okay. So the Secretary made a very brief mention this morning that we've taken a big step. And we're likely to have more to discuss in the months to come.
So one of the things that, when we're talking about the ability of small groups to use off-the-shelf commercial capabilities to really devastating effects, you mentioned off-the-shelf drones. A lot of folks know this. Earlier this fall, there was an incident where ISIS used a drone that they had rigged with explosives to attack basically are, the sides of good, the coalition, and two Peshmerga soldiers died, two French special operators went to the hospital. I've been talking with folks at Jidan. We've got a lot of anti-drone technology, but the problem is getting it out into the field, getting it also to allied partners. And this is a big issue because we develop a lot of this stuff, but getting it out to where people that aren't from the United States, allied militaries can actually use it, seems to kind of go along with this other problem we have, which is getting people from Silicon Valley and their solutions into the Pentagon. It's a question of like whether or not we trust people from outside this institution enough to actually get them technology or get their technology into us. So what do you see as the big obstacle to either one of those two roadblock problems?
There are two obstacles. One is that we've got to keep the price point for the counters low enough to be operationally relevant. We may be able to defend a few points on the map, but if a few points isn't enough for the mission in question, then it's a good capability to have, but not one that actually matters for mission. So it's more of a science project than it is something to transition. When you're talking about trying to deny a $1,000 drone, you've got to keep whatever is the effector of that drone extremely inexpensive. It's going to need to be in the directed energy, cyber EW realm, because as you start moving into kinetic ways to defeat a UAV of that size and that cost, you're probably going to not have a lot of options that start below $1,000 per kill. Mm-hmm. So that's one point. Two is that our processes for sharing capabilities with allies and partners are really things from a previous era where we build exclusive high-end technology to get ready for the Cold War. These are things that are difficult to share. They take a lot of thought because they're not capabilities that you can readily replace if they're compromised or lost by an opponent. There is no reason we should take that process into our current age where so many of the technologies are going to be commercially based. We can all go buy them.
Right.
So you could imagine some kind of Monty Python-esque scenario where we're not able to share a drone that we just bought off the shelf, but an ally or partner could go buy it themselves and have to do that because we can't get the paperwork done. So I think we're going to have to revitalize how we work in commercial tech. And if we do, the only way we're going to beat armed commercial drones is with commercially enabled responses. Because unique, exquisite responses, we simply won't be able to proliferate enough to make a difference.
Right. Well, so let me bring in Sujin Chang here to talk a little bit about that, because that's kind of what DIUX and this entire innovative push is all about, is finding these great kind of engines of innovation out in Silicon Valley and elsewhere and bringing them in. And it's obviously a huge passion of Secretary Carter. He's opening up new DIUX offices all over the place. And yet, when we sat here earlier and there was a panel with Bob Work, and somebody asked, well, what's the obstacle to really getting these solutions, these contracts moving faster, where we can acquire something commercial, move it out to the field really fast? What's the obstacle? And the response was culture. Culture is the obstacle. There's a culture thing. And I think culture, I think like me and my dad and my sister drinking green beer on St. Patty's Day. Like that's not an answer to what's wrong with military acquisition. So I wonder if you can tell us, Ms. Chang, what what is wrong with, what is this culture barrier that we see right now? Is it a person sitting in one contract office, no one knows his name, but he's got way too much power and he can just say no? And how do we fix this?
I love that you asked that question because it shows that you have not worked in the government. Because when we talk about...
I have not. Everyone loves that. That's like the takeaway line. Okay.
Well, when someone says, you know, we have to defeat the contracting culture, we all know what that is.
Right.
And let's not beat up on the contracting people, guys. You know, my favorite joke is that you know, I feel so bad for contracting officers that I married one. And it's true. They have the toughest job. And, you know, when it comes to the culture, or at least changing the culture, I think that it's changing the incentives. Mm-hmm. So, first of all, in the contracting community, you're measured based on the number of protests you're able to avoid or defeat or overcome. You're measured on how much cost savings that you're able to achieve. You're not measured on how fast you're able to get something on contract. So Facebook has this really great quote that's all over their building that says, done is better than perfect. And in the contracting community, we say, perfect is better than protest. And we really need to get over that mindset of the risk fear that we have of protest. I always tell program offices to just assume a protest is gonna happen. That should not be driving your overly cautious behaviors and really dragging out the contracting timeline and not delivering solutions as fast as we need to our warfighters. The second culture aspect is the fact that this is kind of a little secret that I'm gonna tell you that's from the mind of a contracting officer, is that when you do something innovative, you like to keep it a secret. And here's why. Let's say you take a risk and you do some kind of really unique kind of contracting mechanism and you didn't get protested, oversight, policy, legal didn't come bearing down on you. You wanted to keep it a secret because you feel like you dodged a bullet. And people want to kind of, you know, avoid not being exposed. I mean, the last thing you want to do when you've kind of dodged that bullet is put it out to the world for everyone to scrutinize and basically come back and tell you how you did it wrong. Mm-hmm. And so we definitely need to change the culture in terms of the incentives and prioritizing speed and incentives to share and collaborate. A lot of people in this room, you know, are representing organizations that are really trying to affect innovation in DoD. And what I ask of you is that you really need to work with your contracting officer and your acquisition team and develop a business team and a business plan to complement your innovation strategy. You know, I almost feel like I'm here crashing the party, because when we talk about technology and innovation, everyone gets really excited, and then you get to contracting and everyone is, you know, it's kind of like the biggest buzzkill, because we say, oh, we love the idea, wait 18 months, I'll get it to you. And we just simply can't wait 18 months. What you really need to do is work with your contracting officer and your acquisition team to build a business strategy. What does that mean? You need to diversify your contracting mechanisms. A lot of times, everybody looks at contracting and they think, I want to find that loophole. I want to find that FAR Part 60 that tells you you can ignore all the rules if you really, really, really want something. And it doesn't exist. The reality is there are a lot of flexibilities in the FAR. There are a lot of tools. We need to leverage all of them, not just try to find that silver bullet or that skeleton key, but try to find the different contracting mechanisms to support the different types of innovations that we can access. That means take advantage of OTAs, BAAs, CRADAs, BPAs, GSA schedules, sole source contracts. What happens a lot of times is that people want to just use one type of contract mechanism because it worked for them, and then they want to go back to it over and over and over again. And the reality is every contract flexibility has a certain threshold where if you pick at it too much and you exploit it too much, you're gonna get in trouble. So So that's why it's really important to diversify your contracting strategy and create a culture where we are seen as a business partner and a team.
Okay, so one of the things that I hear a lot when I talk to people in Silicon Valley that are making exactly these sorts of innovations that the military is keenly interested in picking up is they're interested in not a competitive contract. They don't want a competitive contract. That takes forever and you have to give away a lot of intellectual property. They're interested in a sole source contract, which takes, you told me earlier, 12 months as opposed to 18 months for a competitive contract, but it's still way too long. And you still have to give away a lot of intellectual property so that the government can make sure that this isn't something that they can compete somewhere else. So without spending too much longer on contracting, this is something that is unique to everybody, what everybody hears, right? I mean, you hear this, Mr. Roper, you hear this clearly, that the burdens for IP and the amount of intellectual property that you have to give up for a sole source contract with the military is just too high.
Well, yeah, good point, Patrick, but I will say one thing. Though you haven't worked in the government, you are getting a contracting officer to respond the same day that you make your question, so you are...
I win!
if you need a job, you let me know.
Okay.
Now, your point's a good one, that we're a Pentagon right now that still has vestiges of a mindset that when we put our money on the table, industry is going to swoop in and sit down, because that's who we were in the Cold War. And as you've heard articulated across the talks today, we had a great track record then. We developed a lot of great technologies that changed the world. That was, and we had a process that made sense for that time and that worked for that time. And what I'm still fighting against in the Pentagon now is people who have that mindset and think that when they put money on the table that a Google or an Amazon or even smaller startup companies that want to be bought by those companies are going to care. No company that's developing a technology that has a whole of world consumer market, so anything in the digital sciences, anything that's in the cell phone or smart device industry, all of that they want to sell to us as a world of people, not a Defense Department of people. Mm-hmm. So the second that we come in and make working with us part and parcel of owning their capabilities, that the government has rights, we will never see those companies.
Yeah.
It not only is going to slow down getting them started, it may mess up their ability to be bought or acquired by a large company that wants their particular specialty. So what I wish we would move towards is a model where we covet speed. Mm-hmm. Speed in the government. You've heard that echoed. It's my biggest fear is that the Defense Department will not change to be fast adapters of commercially enabled technology. So if we are always faster than the rest of the world, we'll always have a temporal window. And so why couldn't we build a model with small companies where we say, we won't own anything you have, but what we want is we want to be able to use your beta version before the rest of the world can. Keep me one version better, and I will help fund the R&D to make your product better so you can go sell to everyone. That is a model that makes sense to me, but we have a very difficult time affecting it right now because we're a Pentagon that still believes that when we spend money, we own product as opposed to owning time.
So on this, there's also a very good reason.
Perfect, thank you.
Yeah, why
can I quote
the
you?
Yeah. Why the Pentagon's a little bit risk averse compared to say buying things on a Silicon Valley timeline. There's this great ethos that like permeates across Silicon Valley. Your objective is to fail cheap, fail often, fail cheap, and that doesn't really work for the Pentagon because there's. I mean, if you fail cheap in Silicon Valley, then your data app didn't get 1 million downloads in its first weekend, and now, oh, gee, you have to go work for Google. You failed. You can't fail cheap when you're doing like the Bin Laden raid, where the consequences are real. So you, as someone who straddles both of these worlds, how do we create an environment where we have a contracting process that's still publicly accountable, where people can't just sort of abscond money and give it to Silicon Valley buddies, where a contracting process where we are still pushing the best possible, safest possible technology to the front lines, but that's still fast enough to compete with the acceleration in consumer technology. How do we do that?
So I dovetail on the last answer The first thing we have to quit doing is quit mixing apples and oranges. Mm-hmm. So I'll quote folks who talk about the horizons of organizations. The Pentagon and the acquisition system was built as a Horizon 1 organization, which means that they are designed to very efficiently use the resources they have to get the work done that they're supposed to do.
Right.
And they have 200% more work to do than they have resources, which means they're absolutely opposed to wasting anything, which drives them to create stovepipes that are very efficient.
Yeah.
Well, unfortunately, between all those stovepipes is all this white space. And what happens in that white space is what's absolutely killing us, because other people don't have those rules. So the first thing we do is we try and create this innovative process, and out come the DFAR regulations from the Horizon 1 organization, and we apply them to the Horizon 3 disruptive innovation organization we're going to build. Mm-hmm. So step one is, if you really want to be innovative and you really want to do this, create a box where you can suspend all those rules, where we don't have to talk about IP at all, mm-hmm. where you can step in and as a program manager and say, you know, I do want to seed this technology because I want to see it move. And I don't want to have to wait a year to get a contract vehicle in place or something else that I give somebody $250,000 in money.
Yeah.
We can do things like simply letting our people go TDY to go sit with the companies and talk to them, mm-hmm. which seems to be one of the biggest inhibitors we have today.
Yeah.
But the idea of understanding the business process that, not just Silicon Valley, anybody in the entrepreneurial world, that their job is to take a napkin drawing, a team, and a little money and build a prototype.
Yeah.
Work through the process and understand what your customer channels are going to be and what the product is going to be. Raise some cash before your equity runs out and build a really big company and sell it. Mm-hmm. And as soon as you set down that pathway, your job is to stay directly on that path.
Yeah.
And unfortunately, the government likes to step in late and ask you to come 5 degrees off it to do something else. At which point, you know, the startup CEOs in the Valley will tell you, I'd love to do that, but mm-hmm. if I did it, there'd be a new CEO here the next day.
Yeah.
My job is to build a $300 million company.
Yeah.
And your million-dollar issue is not going to help me get there.
Yeah.
So we start by first educating folks on the different paradigm that they're dealing with.
Yeah.
But then create a set of rules and places. We educate contracting officers and acquisition officers and other folks to understand that very narrow box where life is going to be different.
Yeah.
And we nurture them forever. Part of the reason that we started the Hacking for Defense course, it wasn't about getting technology. It was about the 10-year issue of growing people who think like this and getting them in the groups where I could actually put them to work.
So this is a great, very detailed discussion about some of the cultural contracting issues that stand in the way of the offset strategy realizing its full potential. But what happens if the offset strategy does realize its full potential and all of a sudden the decision loops start to shift and you've got these incredibly capable technologies permeating the battlefield in a way that shrinks the amount of time that operators have to make decisions? This is something that you talk a lot about, Will, a great deal, which is the shrinking OODA loop. And I wonder if you could sort of outline a little bit some of your thoughts on it, and then we'll discuss what to do if that goes horribly buggy.
It is something I worry about. I think it also something that that Peter has thought about and written about quite well, to give people a sense of what will happen when the time constant of war starts shrinking to the point that you just can't have human decision making as we know it today inside of it. You can see the pieces in play. We're not quite there yet, but we live in a world of ubiquitous sensing machines, right? It's smart, which we put in front of every single piece of equipment today, smart coffee makers, smart refrigerators, everything's smart.
Yeah.
And we all know what that means. It means that it has sensing, it's producing data, and that data is flowing into some central cloud-based repository. So that's piece one, world of sensors, Internet of Things. Piece two is that in the cloud, you know, we're starting to see the emergence of more sophisticated machine learning and deep learning. which is a technology we're very interested in SCO. So that is the thing that is taking all of the data and starts allowing needles in haystacks to be found. So I predict that 10 years from now, kids won't understand what finding a needle in a haystack, what that means. That's just going to mean something a machine does easily. So what, right? It's not going to have the same context. And so once we have algorithms that can understand, it can have understanding at the rate at which we're generating information, what is any national security-minded organization going to think about? Is trying to create actions at the speed of that understanding. And for the US, we just don't see a future where we're not going to have people trying to be part of that action, part of the loop. But other countries may not. And my biggest fear is that countries that don't want to have the same scruples that we do may say, you know what? The third piece is what's already happening in the day trading world where you have machines that are doing tens of thousands of transactions a second. We're already seeing the beginning of software, writing software with the DARPA cyber challenge going on. So the ability to have cyber effects at a rate that is so fast, and we're not talking exquisite cyber, we're talking just simple things, but happening everywhere, 1,000 cuts approach. How could we possibly use our current processes there? And that's a rhetorical question. We won't. So we're going to have to try to develop something that's, and the best analogy I have for this is something that's like a cyber immune system, or that's living down at that small time scale that we've programmed, that we understand how it will work, that can produce diagnostic information that's at the temperature, blood pressure level that a doctor would work at. I'm going to take all these different measurements that tell me what's happening at your immune system, that help me do diagnosis, and then decide what to do in the future, but with no illusion that you're telling individual white blood cells what to do. That's the best analogy I got, folks. But we're going to have to start on that now, because that kind of architecture would be very appealing to me if I weren't worried about machines running out of control, and I wanted to give the US pause into putting pressure on me, I might think about plugging those three things together and saying, let's see what happens.
See, this is an excellent point, because earlier we were talking about culture, right, and how annoyed we are by contracting culture and how it slows everything down. Well, culture is really just an expression of different social and institutional norms. And right now in the Defense Department, we have a social, institutional, moral norm. We have a human on the loop all times when we're talking about machines taking life. Some people don't think that's real, but it's very real. There's a human on the loop at all times.
Always.
It's in a doctrine that Ashgarter himself put out. And there's a question, because this brings this up. At some point, that perhaps begins to look like a cultural relic when we're faced with an adversary that doesn't have the same scruples, that's a little bit more cavalier with human life, or is just happier thrusting poorly designed but very lethal machines into the battle space to have mass effect. And I'm not sure we have a tremendously good defense against it other than a rhetorical moral stance. Do you, Dr. Singer?
Sitting here and listening to the conversation, I'd toss out three challenges that we're going to have to navigate in this space. One is how the heck do you test and war game as this OODA loop shrinks down to inhuman speed? That is the benefit of learning systems. And look, there are specific systems that we're already working on right now, for example, that do targeted identification in a denied environment. So you, if it's learning, on one hand, if you have it inside a box, a test box, you know what it's going to do within a very specific but limited environment. Alternatively, you let it learn out in the world. However, what happens then is it develops approaches that we don't understand or plan for, and that's everything from it takes actions, tactics that the doctrine didn't plan for, to maybe the bigger challenge is, can we legally do that? That is, can we set free a weapon that's learning for good reason? Maybe the learning is to identify when the enemy is trying to trick you from hitting a military versus a civilian target. But the point is, if it's learning, you can't predict its actions, and you're in a very different world. And the environment that we have right now of lawyers signing off on it, at least the discussion so far, is not. So we have to figure out, as we shrink down the OODA loop, are we willing to have systems that evolve in directions that we don't know where they'll head? That may be tactically beneficial, but does it fit our culture? Does it fit our law and the like? The second we'll hit is the idea of just baking in vulnerability. And we look, you know, we reference the Internet of Things. Well, guess what happened last week? You know, we had a massive attack committed by essentially cameras with default passwords on them. And we all thought, oh, it's Russia hitting back, when it turns out it probably even wasn't that. It was a couple of, it may, by one report, it was script kiddies. So we may be baking in vulnerabilities. The same thing when we look at the hardware side that we explored in Ghost Fleet. You know, it's great to have all of this grand new technology that's one step ahead. We're getting your beta, but if the microchip is made by the adversary, you not only have a supply chain problem, you have a hardware hack problem. But the third maybe important one that's uncomfortable for us in this room to talk about is, all of this is great, but if we kludge it on to our old systems, we're not getting full benefit from it. We're like the battleship captains going, I'm totally embracing the air power revolution. I gave up valuable deck space for a float plane. And I think about that, of a lot of the new systems that we're citing, they're almost always taking some old system and adding a little bit. Very cool thing. The float plane was an improvement, but it wasn't the full embrace. And that goes back to the prior question. We, and I say we, journalists, contract officers, defense analysts, military officers, the people in this room, we need to redefine our meaning of failure. So in the conversation earlier at this conference, future combat systems was defined as sort of one of the greatest failures. Was it a failure because we invested in it and we didn't get much? Or could you argue it was a success because we didn't move forward with it? That is, or you see sometimes said, you know, $58 billion is spent on false start contracts that never happen. We look at that, mock it, laugh it, say that's a bad thing. Congress investigates, says that's wasted money. Is it better to push forward with a too big to fail program that then you have to kludge all of this new cool stuff on so you don't get the full advantage of the new?
Let's open it up for questions. We've got a few in front and all over the place. Back here, Flight Global.
James Drew from Aviation Week. Specifically for the Strategic Capabilities Office, could I ask you about the ATACMS Franken missile and how that feeds into the Army's future multi-domain battlefield concept?
ATACMS, right?
ATACMS.
Yeah. ATACMS, so, yeah.
Army programs always have strong names, and so I think it fits in. It fits in really well. You've seen a lot of evolution of Army thinking about what land power is going to be in the 21st century, and we've tried to help from the very beginning of that effort. The multi-domain ATACMS was one of the first examples that we're now discussing publicly, where we've been working on it with the Army for a couple of years, and when we first started, it was very much a program that would have great support and also great antipathy, sometimes within the same organization, because the Army a couple of years ago was, you know, an Army coming out of combat operations in the Middle East, and the most amazing thing I've seen, given really great leadership in the Army from a couple of chiefs of staffs, including the current one. TRADOC, ARCIC, if you speak Army, these are all Army organizations. I know that's, you can treat them as one thing, but they are different personalities. They have all rallied around this idea that land power can enable other domains. It's an obvious conclusion. We cannot relegate powers to individual sections of the globe anymore. And so this is a broader strategy the Army is pursuing. And what we're trying to do in SCO is create as many different options for them to enable it, to be the ways that they start doing it. And the cross-domain attackums will be one of those.
Over here. Yeah.
Thank you. My name is Mindy Reiser. I represent a number of NGOs. This panel is entitled New Perspectives on Defense Innovation. And I want to push the idea of defense a little further. We have United Nations peacekeeping operations and teams from various nations engaged in peace building and peacekeeping. We have problems with development. We have the work that USAID is doing and a number of innovations in those issues, UN Population Fund, etc. What is Silicon Valley doing, perhaps in conjunction with the Department of Defense, in looking at these issues, in providing innovative solutions, in using big data? Because this too is defense, and we need to look very broadly on what defense really entails.
I'll tackle that. At least at New America, we had a project that looked at, obviously robotics, drones, controversial topic. We have one data set that looks at the international trade in drones, 86 different, so offset this, 86 different militaries have bought the systems, Chinese systems used in Nigeria, Iraq, et cetera. But we have another project that looks at the peaceful and peace building side of drones. And the research team went out, went everywhere from the Amazon to Congo to look at how the same technology is being used in everything from archaeology, development, to UN peacekeeping operations, where particularly, as you well know, when they're operating, particularly in like the Congo, they're covering a geographic scale of half the US, but they're doing it with like roughly one brigade. And they've started to utilize unmanned systems to gather information on a wider scale. Now the challenge, and I sort of would push this back to the NGO community, and again to those of us on analysts and media side, is the news stories around it though were UN using drones, and then very quickly the news story article had a predator drone shooting a Hellfire missile, right? and that's, we have to understand, the technology is in essence, and I argue all technology is neutral. It's how and who uses it, what are the safeguards in place. So this, and whether it's big data, all the things we've mentioned can be very powerful tools for organizations like the UN if we're willing to adopt them and if we have the right checks and balances. And oh, by the way, there's a whole private business side to this. Are we going to defer that marketplace to Chinese companies? And so far, that's one of the trend lines that we're seeing.
Over here.
I'd like to carry on with that theme because I'm Dick Vanatta from Institute for Defense Analyses, and the issue of internationalization, globalization, the first offset was purely American with a few foreign scientists that we brought in. The second offset was largely driven by American R&D technology companies with a few Israeli companies like Abe Karams, et cetera. But let's face it, it was US made, US born and raised. We have a globalized environment now. Talk about new perspectives on the offset strategy and defense. How do we integrate with and interlink ourselves with international technology development in a way that also maintains our security?
Shoot.
The answer to your question is really embedded in a broader question that the department is going to have to answer to stay relevant, which is how do we use commercial technology or technologies that are not developed inside the department, whether it's international or domestic, but things that didn't have DoD requirements in them. I think it's our single most significant challenge that we face in the near term, because everything in the apparatus of the Pentagon is based on starting by writing down what we want and then building it, funding it until it happens. And though a lot of people, say that the acquisition process is broken, I think that's overly unkind. The systems that do come out of it, they do tend to work for what we wanted them for. And the issue in question is the cost and the speed. So I think the one thing we're going to have to reinvestigate, and my office is a good example of an experimental outfit that's exploring this for the secretary, is how we innovate without requirements. I don't have any in scope. And so I start with things. Systems like ATACMS, we have it, so what else can we do with it? Or commercial technology that we can go buy off the shelf, or international technology. Then we ask ourselves what else we can do with them. And we're really solving problems with them. That's how you innovate without requirements, is you solve problems and then decide, do you like the solution well enough to buy it? I think if we're able to do that, where we push a technology towards a solution by prototyping, trying it out, and then deciding to buy it, after we've done that, we'll be able to finally do good enough in the department. Department does perfect well. Good enough is hard. And it's said very often, but we have to have a rigorous way to define good enough. And so I don't think we'll be able to write down numbers and say, when we cross this line, we're good enough, and when we cross this line, we're better. I think you do better just to go do it experimentally, to do it empirically. Go test it, go prove it, and if you like it, buy it. Now, that's not a new idea. That's how we built experimental assets during the Cold War. We built them quickly, things like, you know, all the experimental planes we built, right? All of them were tech pushes, and then we decided whether we want them. So why can't we use that same kind of philosophy, but rather than just building experimental planes, do a much broader class of capabilities? And I think the benefit would be huge. We'd keep the industrial base hot, working, on edge, you know, with the next thing always coming. But we would be buying things where we would have a lot more confidence that their price and delivery rate would stay at a level that we predict.
Ms. Chang, scale of 1 to 10, with 10 being outrageously broken and 1 being just fine, where is the acquisition process in your view?
So I told Patrick not to ask me this question.
And I didn't listen.
And I'm gonna answer it this way. So the acquisition system, when it's designed for large programs, does produce capabilities. And I think when we're here talking about innovation, we're talking about innovation in all different levels. And I think that we have to really keep that in mind. You know, the SCO here is great because, as Will said, they operate without requirements. They're able to do the technology reconnaissance, see what's out there, and then insert it into some kind of capability that will enhance, you know, our current programs. But the question really is tech transfer. So once you've passed that R&D phase and you've done proof of concept, what you have to really think through is how it actually becomes inserted into the acquisition cycle. It may be that it will be a part of an existing program as part of their modernization effort while they're in ONS. It may become a part of the development cycle of a new acquisition program. It may just become a brand new acquisition in and of itself. So there's a lot of different options that need to be thought through when you're doing the tech transfer from an innovation that occurs in the R&D phase and how to cross the chasm into an actual program of record.
There's a great slide, I don't know if any of you have ever seen it, that actually it perfectly illustrates this chasm. It's called the DARPA gap. You've seen the DARPA gap slide, and over here there's like all the stuff that DARPA makes, and here's all the stuff that DARPA made that turns into something, and in the middle there's this huge dip where like just cool pet rocks are just buried for all of intellectual history, and that's just a perennial problem.
And I think that's really important why you have to think through the acquisition strategy, even when you're doing the R&D, because you know, involving someone that does the DoD 5000 acquisition management, because they can start thinking through exactly how it should transition into the program side, so that it doesn't become the pet rock that you know, die on the vine kind of thing.
Right.
As they can make those plans early, then you're also able to, you know, again, leverage the diversified contracting strategies, and early on, as soon as that contract has done, you know, proof of concept, you already have a plan to transition it somewhere immediately. Where we see the gap is, you know, we've done proof of concept, and then we have to wait and figure out the next contract mechanism, how to get it into the program. And at that point, you waited another 18 months before you can even, you know, continue to leverage that technology. Right. So I think that that's a gap that really needs to be addressed.
All right. Singer, you wanted to ask?
I wanted to return to the question because I think there's two parts of it that are valuable to explore. One is we make the historic parallel to the first and second offset for a variety of reasons. It's in the name. Many of the players are still around or respected. There's an argument to be made that they're not the best parallels to learn from and copy from. That a better parallel when we think about the true sweep of change that we're talking about here is 1920s and 30s. And related to your question, it means, you know, so the, one of the gaps as I see it is not just sort of the tech question, but where are our versions of the fleet problem exercise, the Louisiana maneuvers? We're doing a lot of cool wargaming. We're doing a lot of cool small unit. The large unit ones aren't truly breaking the box in the way the fleet problem exercise did, or Louisiana maneuvers are. And I don't just mean in terms of, wow, this is a fundamentally different doctrine than what I was doing before, rather than a sort of mix of let's get back to basics and tweak it with this. But it also, what was notable about back then, was it also linked to personnel system. People essentially advancing or not in their careers, determining on sort of things that played out there. There's also, to your other part of your question, which is the allied side, when we look at the exercising that we're doing with our allies, it's mostly partnership capacity building that's a mix of making them feel good about themselves and or build little versions of us. And when you think about the overall needs of the third offset as it links to grand strategy, that may not be what we want here. Ultimately, we want, as we did, to create dependencies on us, both so that we can turn to them, but they also don't have other choices. But also, we don't want to create scenarios where they go off and take actions that might suck us into conflict. A more direct way of putting this, and it links to why I'm excited about, for example, the return of the Army and the Marine Corps to their true historic heritage, coastal defense. Sorry, awkward, but that's if you look at the history. Do we want the Japanese to go out and seize disputed islands? Or actually, do we want them to be able to defend disputed islands? But which are we doing exercises with them on?
Let's take Zach over here.
Zach Biggs with Janes. I wanted to go back to the acquisition question. I think, assuming I was listening to the same panel that Peter was, he was being kind and not mentioning the person who brought up FCS, but that was Frank Kendall. And it was part of a broader defense of the current acquisition system that he was providing. And his argument was essentially that while it is slow when you're looking at a lot of different platforms that are going to be around for decades, factoring in all of the considerations that are necessary to have a system last that long is important and that it needs to continue. A lot of what this panel's been describing is increasing or reducing the time period it takes, increasing the speed, trying to get things faster through the acquisition system. Does it then make sense that there should be two parallel tracks? Is that the underlying assumption here or the conclusion that there need to be two very separate systems for trying to go through acquisition so that you can have that long lead time, long development of platforms versus very quick acquisition of shorter term products? Or do we really need to throw out the entire system, and is that longer term development approach simply antiquated?
Sure.
Go ahead.
You know, it's an interesting way of putting it. We have an incredible capacity to perfectly solve the wrong problem. So rather than talk about parallel systems and other things, is we rarely talk about what it takes to find the problem that we need to solve and adequately describe it and build the social ecosystem that goes with it that lets us understand the pace of technology is just moving with the pace of decay of our understanding of the problem. Essentially saying is every problem's got a half-life. And the longer it exists, the more likely it's gonna change before we get to something. Technology's got a pace of growth. And a real challenge is being able to put the right people in the right room to bring their understanding of the pace at which the problem is moving and the technology associated with it, to gather the right people to work with it, which is a human capital problem, and then to understand the pace at which the technology is moving. That when you can bring all three of those understandings together at one time, then it's pretty easy to get the contracting system and the acquisition system and everybody else to work together to actually do something. The problem is we don't educate and form groups like that inside our system. So whether it's a parallel system that comes together or whether it's the same system that has different behaviors, none of it really matters as long as we do our homework up front and we get to the point where we can do this. We talk about the idea in the valley of killing off ideas fairly quickly. But the idea of killing off ideas really quickly is about throwing as many things out there to get to this understanding as you possibly can so that you can put your resources into building the right thing as fast as possible. Yet our system looks at any extraneous other stuff other than having the perfect answer as being wasteful. So at some point, we have to learn to invest in better understanding the problem before we throw it on the table. We have to invest in getting the right people to the table, which means you're going to have to do some prototyping. You're going to have to invest in, we don't even have the same language between the two organizations. The word prototype means something different in the DoD than it does in the commercial world. Yet we're trying to bring the two of them together. Somewhere in there the answer, but we haven't done the homework up front that even allows us to get to that point.
I wonder, on this, when we've got a very big idea, big programs that we need to pursue well to achieve dominance in the battle space of the future, and it seems like so much of what's coming out of talking about asking the right questions about the right problems, so much that's coming out of Eastern Europe right now, particularly Ukraine, has surprised the defense establishment, it seems, pretty basically across the board. Are we asking the right technological problems for based on our experiences in Eastern Europe? What has changed about the questions that we're asking and the problems that we're seeing?
We're still very device specific. So in that way, we're kind of a decade behind the time. We live in a world that is data centric. Mm-hmm. Data is going to be the fundamental fuel for national security into the foreseeable future. Industry covets data. Data is the thing that you use to build the next product line to sell to us. But we still have a very antiquated view of it. So we're not safeguarding, stockpiling our data and then turning it into new pattern of life, new algorithms, new learning machines that think faster, see quicker, help us respond better. So I think that's one thing that's going to have to change. We need to transition from the computer-centric department to the data-centric compartment and fight in the information age. I think the other thing we're going to have to come to grips with is that many of the sources of information that are going to be the best for us are not going to be DoD or government sources. It's mm-hmm. going to be the world of sensing around us. And almost always, I think when an event happens in the world, we'll go back in the aftermath and we'll find that some person at the right place took a picture and it was on Instagram and we could have known, but it was one thing in the midst of many. So it goes back to the thing we've been discussing all day. That seems like a problem that a machine could sort out mm-hmm. if we put the time and effort into it. But it's going to have to sort it out much faster than a person can. Yep. And so we're going to have to smartly let some of the reins go without letting strategic effects go.
Yeah.
And I don't see that as an impossible design challenge. White blood cells and the immune system analogy we discussed earlier, white blood cells don't have names. Right? They all act the same. They're predictable. They're probabilistic. But they're, in effect, they're autonomous systems in our body. Right? We're not controlling them, but yet they do things that help us. I could see us building simple AI systems that perform simple tasks in a predictable way, not in a non-deterministic way, as if they had personalities, that would enable us to make decisions quicker without putting us on a dangerous slope. And I think the earlier we start building at least prototypes in that space where we're following current data science, we'll finally be turning the page on what the offset will become, which is a very data-centric approach to national security.
So I take what you are saying, and there's an aspect of it that frightens me very deeply, which is the integrity of data and how questionable that is increasingly becoming. So earlier today, we were all sitting around, and Bob Work talked about Bellingcat and how Bellingcat, this fantastic collective of open source intelligence analysts, they're just folks around the world that look at information, played a role in attribution of the MH17 downing, right? So they were looking at pictures coming out of Eastern Europe, and they were able to quickly put together evidence that showed that it was a book fired by a Russian separatist, given to that Russian separatist by Russian forces. And you tweeted, hey, we don't need a lot of time to figure out the attribution, and this Bellingcat was doing it almost instantaneously. And it's true, this is the amazing advantage of open source intelligence collection right now. But the same group suffered a tremendous hacking attempt from the same Russian espionage unit that's trying to hack the United States election. And there's a lot of worries about their ability to perhaps change information, to change data, to change the very lifeblood of this new battle space. So this brings me to your cover story in The Atlantic right now on the information war, which is an aspect of war that we don't really talk about, but I think that we have to. Are we winning it? Is it something that we are even prepared to fight in the same way? We're sitting here talking about battle systems. Meanwhile, like, a room full of dudes in Moscow can completely undermine our own faith in our democracy. So are we winning the information war, can we?
Well, let me first, you know, you're one of those awful mainstream media people. You didn't tell the full story, okay. So on one hand, it is clear, so the same group using the same tactics and technologies attacked Bellingcat when it was investigating the shootdown over Ukraine. Mm-hmm. It attacked the World Anti-Doping Agency after Russian Olympic athletes were caught there. It also went after the Joint Staff, various Pentagon emails, and it went after the Democratic National Committee. That's one side of the story. Mm-hmm. On the other side, Vladimir Putin and Donald Trump have said, no, that's not the case. So we need to tell both sides of the story, okay? I did, all right. Now that we've established both sides of the story, we can move on. And it actually is a way of hitting the challenge that's here, the opportunity and the challenge of this. So the Internet of Things overall, we're moving to roughly 50 billion devices, but when you crunch the number of sensors out there, be it smart cars, your phone on your camera, basically you reach roughly a trillion sensors. So there's massive amounts of information there to be mined. Arguably, there are no more secrets. The bin Laden raid is simultaneously being live tweeted. The Russian moves into Crimea are already up on various social media sites before they cross the border. The pushback to it, though, is an information warfare campaign to bury the truth underneath a sea of lies. So, for example, yes, we can document not just that it was a Russian missile, we can even identify which individual Russian soldiers pulled the trigger solely off of social media. However, there have been at least 14 different other competing theories pushed out online. Everything from RT to the Wikipedia page itself is a battleground. And that's what we're seeing play out here. So it's harder to sift through because what we have is, you know, Clausewitz's fog of war just turned into kind of digital means and deliberately created. And that's one of the things that the AI is going to, yes, we're going to be turning towards it to sift through, but also it's going to have to deal with constant sort of classic human trickery.
Right.
And oh, by the way, will you believe it or not if it doesn't square with your prior worldview?
Right.
And that's really what we're seeing also play out in the election. Facts may matter less if it doesn't square with the way you already see the world, which is, oh, by the way, what constantly happens in war. You know, December 7, 1941, we've got the data on the Japanese bombers are coming in, but it didn't square with the way they looked at the world because, no, that must be a training flight.
Right.
That's what we're gonna have to wrestle with here.
So if our future AI overlord is reading Breitbart, we're doomed, is pretty much where you can take that. Go ahead.
I'm done. Hello, I'm Samira Daniels, Ramsey Decisions. This is for to follow up on Pete's last comment, which is really, you know, sort of the nub, I think, of a lot of what we are facing in terms of information and the third offset. At what level, and I raised this to one of the panelists on the other side, at what level are we going to discuss this whole issue of the informational issues that you just raised? I mean, somebody has to do it. Otherwise, you know, we're sort of, I mean, we could be misled in so many ways, and the legitimacy and the legality are some of the issues, you know, that you have raised yourself.
Well, I'll toss two quick things out, and then one of them is actually a question to the other people on the panel, which is, so one, we're clear, this information warfare side is the other side of the coin to the discussion that we've been having on cyber conflict. So, you know, much of our focus has been on adversaries getting inside our networks. What this is getting inside our human network, our politics, and this is an old playbook. It starts out with Russia in the 1940s, and it's been used against Hungarian election, et cetera. It feels new to us, but it's age old. So we've got to deal with that. But the other thing, and this is what I want to pose back to the other, I feel like part of the third offset story, though, is also a story of how our relationship with data may change because of adversary action, in that we've had for the last generation too much data coming at us. How do we sift through all of this data, whether you're in a talk in Iraq or a KOC or whatever, you've got everything from full motion video, you've got hundreds of emails. How do you find the most important thing? But when we look at third offset scenarios, it's an adversary who may turn the spigot off, where you may not have the data, or they're giving you false information, planting false data in a way that, you know, insurgents couldn't.
Yeah, I think Pete's exactly right. So if the hypothesis that data is the most important factor for national security moving into the future for a variety of reasons, then data is also a weapon, and perception war is a weapon, and it has always been so. But things going viral is not a new phenomenon. Think the beginning of World War I. But the way it happens today is fast. It's fast and ubiquitous. So that's going to be the leading edge of conflict. And I think that policy will have a tough time keeping up with the technologies that enable it. And we have a tough time in the Defense Department fighting anything we can't see. So we have maritime pictures to help us understand the air. We have to help us understand the sea, air pictures to understand the air. We don't have an information picture. We're working very hard on trying to build one using big data tools so that we can see the attacks that are happening to us in the perception war. And exactly as has been highlighted by Peter and by several people today and other panels, if our perception receiver were not human-based, but we're radar-based, we'd say we're being jammed. We're being saturated, and so we can't detect any of the small signals that we need in order to move. And so we're going to have to rewrite our book on information warfare. We're going to have to view it as a cross-domain entity itself, because the things that influence us cross many different domains. And we in the Defense Department are just a piece of that broader thing. And if we don't do it, then my biggest fear is we can get the offset right. We can have amazing systems. We can be ready to win wars. And in SCO, we love surprises. We may have the greatest surprises behind the door that we'll never use, because we wouldn't be able to win the perception war that the cause at hand was worth American involvement. And so everything is frozen, because things made out of neutrons and protons move so much slower than perceptions that are made at the speed of electrons and photons. So if you ask where do we need to dominate the most, what's the most important battlefield to be the most maneuverable, the most adept, the most agile, it's in that world of electrons and photons, because that's the leading edge of future conflict.